Okay, I'd like to call the meeting to order for Budget Committee. First on the agenda is the fire safety plan. If there is any kind of issue of that nature, the main exit is here, there is an exit there, and there is one outside on the committee room. And find your way downstairs and wait. Disclosure of pecuniary interest in nature thereof. See that? There is no correspondence. Correspondence from Dee Kilburn, CIBC Investment Counselor, with the 2019 Q2 Investment Report. Is there any questions or comments from council? Recommend receipt for information purposes. Yes, can I get a mover and seconder on that, please? Moved by Deputy Mayor Andrews, seconded by Councilor Meadows. All in favor? No business from previous minutes. New business. 5.1, Gabe Goodrich, Finance Manager, S. Brown, Tax and Revenue Manager, and S. Crooks, Procurement and Payables Administrator, read the 2019 Second Quarter Q2 Financial Report. Just a brief comment on that. It looks to be in good shape with including all departments, including the police and library, were at 55.68% of budget remaining. So after the 50% mark, we're in good shape. Once again, may I have a mover and a seconder to receive that? Moved by Councillor Bickle, seconded by Deputy Mayor Andrews. All in favor? That's carried. 5.2, Dee Baxter, Director of Finance, read the 2020 Budget Development Initiation. Recommend that Budget Committee provide guidance on the 2020 budget, including identify any service level changes committee requests to be considered, identify any other considerations for discussion or inclusion, and identify a target municipal levy increase to existing taxpayers. And at that point, I'd like to open it up a little bit for some discussion from council. Mayor?
Thank you, and through the chair, the service levels changes. I think the addition I'd like to have under discussion is the introduction of having a CAO come. That will be a budget item for next year, but I'd also like to have it pre-approved that we can start to look for it if the council supports that. So a CAO in the budget would be a request, please.
Changing climate, we are seeing more and more stormwater not only in the lake and rivers, but through the ditches, and we've seen that in the last major storm that we had. We had a huge amount of rainwater coming down specifically through our streets as well as through the rural areas. There was a significant flood over at Balch Road and Lakeshore Road. So it's been a while since we've had a thorough program in the rural world, especially for ditching culverts and so on, and it is a big project, but I think considering the climate change that's happening right now, we need to develop a plan for looking after these ditches, not just patchwork as the most critical ditches need work, but we need to come up with a plan. So I'd like to see some sort of budget used for planning and going forward in the next few years as far as fixing our ditches.
Mayor Andrews?
Totally in agreement with Councillor Lees. I would say for through Parks, Rec and Culture, two of our main priorities are certainly the Senior Center and Splash Pad. Senior Center being $3 million, with both levels of government coming in with encouragement, they're going to be announcing their infrastructure money coming out this fall, so we'll know more about that. Splash Pad, $300,000 with grant opportunities and fundraising. And within keeping, those are two certainly within keeping with our strategic plan. And I would suggest the other two might be the Memorial Park Cenotaph upgrades, with Legion's funding the Legion is fundraising and giving us $100,000, with potential for a Veteran Affairs grant of $25,000, which would leave $10,000 up to the municipality, which is in keeping with the grant from the Veterans Affairs, that they would get $25,000 if we also commit. And the second, or the fourth one then, through Senior Center, Memorial Park, Splash Pad, the fourth one would be the hub upgrades to the kitchen, and that would be looking at about
$60,000. Thank you. Councilor Bickle?
Just like to add to what Vicki said about the ditching, not only the ditches need to be looked at, we need to look at our shoulders of our roads and get rid of that 8-10 inches of buildup of sand from sweeping over the prior years, as well as doing the ditches. Ditches aren't going to work if the water can't get to the ditches, so we need to look at the ditches and the shoulders at the same time.
Quite an aggressive list here, so good for us. Now we have to find a way to fund it, and which is always the challenge, but I agree with Jeff, we're up for the challenge, so let's make some decisions and give some direction to our budget team. Is there a basic level that everybody is comfortable with as far as tax levy increase? Councilor Lees?
Myself, with the cost of living and increases, I looked at this quite a bit on the weekend. I would look at a 2% or below what I'd be comfortable with on a base rate for an increase.
And do you have any recommendations on financing some of these other initiatives that we're talking about?
Well, like Councilor Meadows said, the Senior Center is going to be a dementia, it's going to be a joint thing, and we're looking at federal, provincial money helping us as well. Maybe there could be also some fundraising in there as well. A lot of our other buildings we fundraised when we built the Town Park Rec Center. The addition to the Jack Berger, all those things, there was a good potential for fundraising in that, and also the splash pad. There's grant money available and also fundraising available for those two projects that I suggested. So I think it'll be all joint projects between feds, provincial, us, and the community. And I'm sure people would be willing to help us raise for the seniors center plus the splash pad.
Thank you. Also through the senior center and the splash pad, we can access development charges on both of those. So I think that's going to be helpful as well. And a reserve fund.
Thank you.
I'd like to have council discuss a little further the base rate. Councilor Lee has said 2%. The cost of living indication is 2%. So if we have 2% cost of living, and we know the municipality generally does not meet that requirement, it's usually above, I think that's not going to be sufficient to in fact, even hold the line. So I think the cost of living should be, you know, a point of reference. And then I think from a council perspective, looking at what we have to do and recognizing that the county did 3%, right, and that we have other costs. I'd like a discussion that said 2% is the cost of living. That's a given, right? And if you want to accomplish anything past the cost of living, and given that even that will not sustain us, then I think we're, you know, at least 1 to 1.5% above the cost of living just to do the basics. And then if we look at our strategic plan and the goals we'd like to do over 3 years, you know, I think we need to ask staff to have a look at that, how we can accomplish that, and what would be the financial impact of doing some of these projects that we discussed, and relative to the strategic plan. I've always maintained, if you have a strategic plan and you don't support it with the budget, you do not have a strategic plan. The budget is your strategic plan. So at you know, the cost of living only, it has a good appetite with the public. Nobody wants to see their taxes go up, including all us property owners. But the reality is, if we want to move forward, you know, we need to get some creative thinking, some aggressive approach. Many of the projects that we're talking about, you know, I think particularly the senior center and combined center, we hope to get funding for it, but I think we have to be committed to moving it forward with or without funding. This has been on our books for a long time. I'm certainly optimistic, and we've had, you know, discussions with the governments about it, that it will come, but I don't want to move forward and say it's contingent upon funding, because some of the priorities, the splash pad we'd like to have, if we don't get funding, we can't do it. That's one thing. But if in fact we want to move ahead with a, you know, addition to the agriculture park and address the seniors' needs, you know, we need to do that. Bottom line is, you know, the 2% cost of living will not, I think, bode well for accomplishing what we want to accomplish. So I'd like to open that up to discussion, Chair.
One thing I think we should provide our finance staff with is the ability to get at the interest on the LLRW funds, and we should be prepared to adjust the bylaw so that it isn't necessarily used to reduce taxes. We can find probably a better application for it.
Yes, I would agree with the Deputy Mayor's comment. I do understand what you're saying, that the cost of living is going up. 2% isn't going to give us much more, but in the rural area, we're still paying off the 10-year phasing. So asking a further increase, I don't see that going well in the rural area, but if we can use more of the interest from the LLRW fund rather than refund it on taxes, I think that would definitely go a long way, for sure.
Some of the projects that have been mentioned, and I'm specifically thinking long-term, the ditching and the culverts and the road, I think we have to establish a long-term plan that takes into consideration climate change and what that's doing to our infrastructure in the rural part.
I'll just follow up on the comments about the LLRW funding. We put a bylaw in place this term to indicate from a rural perspective that the interest revenues should be used against taxes. The reason for the bylaw was not to carved in stone, but it was to make sure that if we had any discussion relative to it, it would be in public. The issue that we will deal with, regardless of whether you take the cost of living as a base or not, is that we have incorporated that into our tax base, the revenues, and there's been a refund against taxes. And I think it has better use, quite frankly, there's no question about that. But that when that's done, it will have a tax implication for sure, because we've lowered the taxes based on using that against taxes. So referred to sort of grandma's dowry, we're playing with it a little bit when we do that. So if that's withdrawn and used for other purposes, which is probably better as an investment, and I'm totally in line with all that, then we need to ask what the impact was from staff relative to the levy, because it will have a one-time impact, and this is a year that if we pulled that out, this budget would reflect that.
Can you make any comments for that, Director Baxter?
So for using the LLRW funds in the rural area, to the average taxpayer, $254,000, it decreased their tax bill by $72. So if we were not to do that the subsequent year, then they would see such a $72 increase in the final amount that they paid, and you would then be doing taking sold $184,000 roughly, and then be able to use those funds for a different purpose. But it would definitely have an impact on the taxpayer. In the urban area, we use less funds, and obviously there's a larger tax base, so the impact there was $16.
Now, you're using an average figure for the rural fund, and if we stripped out those large corporations that benefit the most, what would be the reject number for the average resident? Because they don't get the benefit of that full package. Big chunks of go elsewhere.
Right, so the only number I can provide right now is based on the average home. So this is on $254,000 residential property. It's a $72. If you're looking at a significantly higher value residential value or a commercial or industrial property, their reduction would be significantly higher. I think that's
right. So that when we're really not catering to the bigger user, the bigger corporation, such as the gas company or whoever, and so I'm not concerned about them, but I am concerned about giving the right message to the residential unit holders of an accurate number. That what are they really getting? I mean, it's nice to talk averages, but they're not getting anywhere near that $72.
No, they would be. That isn't the average reduction of all of the rural taxpayers. That's the average residential ratepayer reduction.
Everything else is being stripped out. And why that?
That's just me picking. If you own a home at $254,000, your reduction is $72.
Okay, right? So I'm looking at it another way. So let's say we had $300,000 coming in for the rural point on interest. And we took out Union Gas and Enbridge and Bell and whoever else are the big benefactors of this tax reduction. Then we divided by the number of houses. What would that number be? That's the number I'm looking for.
That I can't tie off the top of my head.
Not off the top.
I would anticipate it would probably at least triple.
I'm sorry?
I would anticipate it would probably at least triple.
No, I'm thinking it should be a third. Because if it's $200,000, that $300,000 is going to the big guys, and we're dividing up the remaining $100,000, that's the impact.
Right.
That's what they're really getting in tax savings, right?
Right, so if we removed everybody else, the savings they would get would be significantly higher. If we removed all the commercial industrial properties from receiving a rebate and only issued a rebate to the residential properties, the rebate they would receive would be significantly higher.
Yeah, but I'm saying that I really just want a number that we can go back to the public with that says, you're really not getting $72 benefit out of this fund. You're getting a whole lot less because chunks of it are going up here higher and you're not benefiting from that. But we can sit down and we can go through the numbers.
Yeah, I'm thinking what you mean is instead of $184,000 being used to decrease the typical residential property taxation, it's really only a small fraction of that $184,000 that is actually impacting the typical rate card. I think that's what you mean.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we were both right.
Yes, Mr. Mayor.
That's pretty rare that you're both right. But the other thing that would come to line with that is if you use that total amount of money to invest in the community, it would be significantly better. Those large corporations don't probably benefit truly from the rebate that they're getting, and they're getting a big chunk of it because they're big taxpayers. If you took the total amount that fund earns and applied it to an economic development, I think your return on investment is far better than having a small reduction in taxes.
Agreed.
That also applies to the urban, by the way.
Agreed. Sorry? Councilor Meadows?
I could just maybe get off topic just for a second. I just wanted to say I am comfortable with the 3% max in the budget this year. And I'm also curious to know, what are we looking at for any disaster relief for our waterfront or for the high water levels that I've seen other municipalities maybe perhaps benefiting from? If we got a plan on that? I'm not sure who that
No, so to start in any of those funds, we would have to have incurred costs in excess of $600,000. So I don't believe our level of damage would allow us to be able to apply those forms.
Okay, thank you.
So the as Mayor Sanderson said, the county came up with a 3% number initially, but what they really asked for was 2.6, and a provision for a undetermined amount of increase to handle any of the potential downloads the Ontario government was going to throw their way. They didn't know what they would be, but when the county council was apprised that it could be in the 5% or higher range, county council I don't think it really understood what was being asked of them and said, well, we can't take 5% to our residents, we will give you 3. So what they accomplished was they gave 0.4 over the 2.6 that the county hadn't requested and still hadn't looked at the potential downloads. So their philosophy right now is very flawed, in my opinion.
Any other comments? Mr. Mayor?
I just want to summarize, because I think what we're trying to do here is give staff some preliminary direction. And I certainly think that if we want to ask them to do a couple of things, I think a 3% is a reasonable target, right? And see what you can get done for 3% given the day-to-day and the service levels. And we're changing the service levels, should we add a CAO? On that point, I think by adding a CAO at the cost of a CAO, we'll be getting that benefit out of the current structure that the directors have. So, the traditional CAO concept is not what I am recommending. I'm recommending a quarterback, a resource person. So there will be an impact on the budget, but I think that the effectiveness, you know, of the organization will increase dramatically. If we then also go to a 3%, it doesn't address our strategic priorities. Okay, it does not address, you know, the Ruth Clark Center. It does not address splash pads and some of the other things. So I think we have the option of asking staff to look at what that would cost, you know, effectively on the levy. So it might be 2 points, it might be 3 points, I don't know. If we also look at the same time the relationship with the revenues from the LLRW fund, and we leverage those specifically to the strategic and economic benefits that we have available over the term of this council, and we'd be looking at a three-year window, effectively, to get many of the projects done that we want to get done. So for me, the 3% is the day-to-day requirements. I don't think you're going to get much extra for that. And we have some personnel requirements. So I think from a staff perspective, I'd like to see what the impact is of taking the LLRW funds and applying them to the strategic plan priorities and economic growth, and or to combine it with some sort of assessment from a levy perspective. What would it take to get some of these things done? I don't see council going through another term of status quo where we're not getting things done. The Riverwalk, we've done a lot of work on it, and Parks and Rec has done a lot of work on it, but it's not where it should be, right? And with the working group that we're going to put together, when we first came to office, everybody, you know, was very adamant that the asset, the Athabasca River, and the course, you know, was an economic driver. We haven't achieved that goal, you know, technically. I think we're making it better. We're progressing it very, very well. And we see, you know, people like the Kinsmen Club stepping up, and you know, there's some activity. But it's not enough. And if we just keep moving slowly like this, and we don't have a good plan in sight for that river, I think we're missing an economic opportunity. So I'd certainly like to see staff do some assessment on taking the LLRW funds and applying them on an economic basis. If that then tied to the strategic goals we had without adding any levy and using only those as investment, you know, and if we could put as a target a 3%, then hopefully staff will next month come back in September, you know, and give us some idea what that looks like. So right now we're not trying to set the budget as much as I think we're trying to set a bit of a tone, give some direction to staff, you know, and achieve some of the goals that we've all indicated. We've all said, you know, that you know, affordable housing is important. It's in our strategic plan. How are we going to achieve it? You know, it might be that we have to put a special levy on for affordable housing. So these things need to be worked out. And I think we will be quite capable of doing that with staff help. But if we can give them some initial direction, they can come back and say, you know, what's working, what's not working. But without doing that, I think, you know, we're letting the staff down a bit, because then they don't know what we want, or we're giving kind of no direction. And that's not a good scenario. So that was a roundabout way to get to a couple of basic points.
Thank you. Any other comments? At this point in time, is everybody comfortable with directing staff to go with a 3% base levy increase? Can I get a mover and a seconder for that? Sorry?
I'll move, but then I'll be
cool. Okay, go ahead and make your comment.
I think the budget development cycle that Dr. Baxter has laid out is a good one, but I think we're going to need more council involvement through the fall, as opposed to leaving it all to the departments and then to the finance area to come back to us with the budget. I think we should just keep the ball rolling amongst us, all of us. So, because we've got quite a shopping list, and we can't do everything, so we may have to make some decisions along the way.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, So we'll carry on with that. Everybody comfortable at this point with 3% base? Moved by Les, seconded by John. All in favor? 3%? Okay, so we'll go with that as our base. And over and above that, we will direct council to work with some of the requests, or sorry, direct staff to work with some of the requests that have been brought forward this evening. And I've made note of them all, and I will pass them along to Director Baxter and ask him to work with the other staff on seeing what we can do through use of LLRW funds, and if there's any other levels of government funding available on any of these things that we're discussing now that maybe could be put into this year's budget. There are also a couple of items that have been asked to be pre-approved. So I would like to ask that a report be brought forward to the September Budget Committee meeting to consider providing pre-budget approval for the municipal website improvement project in order to be compliant with accessibility improvement legislation requirements. And further, that a report be brought forward to the September Budget Committee meeting to consider providing pre-budget approval for a one-ton truck for plow and rural road snow clearing. And further, that the addition of a CAO be brought forward for providing pre-budget approval. And that the committee receive the guidelines and timelines outlined in this report for information and direct staff to prepare the 2020 operating and capital budgets based upon our discussions here tonight. Can I have the mover and seconder, please? Moved by Deputy Mayor. Seconded by Councilor Meadows. All in favor? No? Okay, that's carried.
A question on the list anticipated operating adjustments. Community grants $35,000. I didn't understand if that's limiting us to $35,000 for community grants or not. Could you just?
No, that's at a previous budget meeting we agreed to go to a percentage. So last year what was in community grants will be increased by 35% to go to that 1% that we, or half a percent I think, that had been proposed by the deputy mayor. Jay McCormick, Director of Parks, Rec and Culture, fire alarm panel emergency purchase at Town Park Rec Center. Recommend that the cost of the emergency purchase to replace the Town Park Rec Center fire alarm panel and pull stations in the amount of $10,407.10 inclusive of net HST be funded from the 2019 contingency budget. May I have a mover and a seconder on that? Mayor Sanderson and Councillor Lees, all in favor? That's carried. Any other business for discussion tonight? Any questions? Mr. Mayor?
Just with our discussion, there was some hesitancy on council to support a motion that sort of came forward. And I'd like to understand from staff, if possible, some clarity on what their understanding is of what council has asked.
May I ask Director Baxter to clarify that for answer that, please?
in regards to the budget, I presume. So we have an approved motion to come forward with a 3% base budget. We are bringing the two pre-budget approval reports forward for our budget committee meeting, one about a website, one about a one-ton truck. And then in addition to the staff recommendation is the addition of a CAO position, which would also have a pre-budget approval to be report to be brought forward. And then staff will proceed with the guidelines and timelines as we have identified in the report, which is really consistent with prior years. I'd like to have the budget approved again this year in December. That is the formal direction that we've received, and I've certainly taken notes of other comments that have been made by individual committee members, but do know that they are comments made, not direction that we've received. Bring that back to our senior management team and discuss it.
And I believe there was also a request to see about the LLRW funds being used to fund some of the additional items and for staff to bring back to council what that would look like.
Is there a third motion then that I missed, or is that added into the second motion?
I'm sorry, I thought we had agreed upon that a little previous.
There was definitely discussion about it, just in terms of direction.
Okay.
Yes, I think we just moved a 3% increase, but we didn't include the LLRW final motion, I don't think.
Okay. I think I've missed that then, so.
That's okay, and just in terms of it, because I know we do have some standing direction out of previous, to look when we started using the 80% rule of how much we would use. I can't remember that specifically, but we also have existing bylaw direction. So I just want to be cognizant that any motion we have can't supersede a bylaw that is in place. It can bring something forward kind of for consideration, but we can't pass something here as a motion that's then going to supersede the bylaw that we have in effect.
Mr. Mayor?
Thank you for the clarification, because that's what I'm looking for. I think from a council perspective, I'd like to see staff look at the impact of taking the LLRW revenues and taking away from applying against taxes and put them to the use to support the strategic plan. Not as a done deal, but I'd like to certainly understand what impact that would have on taxes and what impact it would have on accomplishing some of the strategic goals that we have. I don't know if that needs to be a motion particularly, or just a request of staff supported perhaps by council, or it can be a motion. I'd probably refer to the clerk relative to which is the best way to give that direction.
Thank you, through you, Madam Chair. I mean, generally we're not giving direction for staff to come back with something for consideration. We did that here tonight, I think in an effort to involve council or budget committee sort of more upfront in the budget process. In regards to the question from the mayor, I think a simple motion directing, looking to see what you're trying to do there, a simple motion would be the best manner to move forward on that. That way it will be recorded in the minutes to the director's comments about whether or not that's, I mean, the impacts of doing that when there's previous bylaws on the books. Well, that would form part of the report to come back to council or committee.
So I would make that a motion that we'd ask staff to look at the impact from a tax perspective on withdrawing or taking the LRW revenues, applying them 80%. I still think we should keep 20% going back into the fund to keep it current, but 80% of those revenues taken away from the tax rebate concept, and see what that impact is. And in addition to that, what would be required to effectively make that happen. So impact and the processes to make that happen should we decide to do so. Because I pointed out, there is a bylaw, it's there for a reason, we need to have some debate. But I think for the September meeting, we need to have that come forward. So the motion, in its most simple terms, is asking staff to look at the impact of withdrawing the LLRW funds, 80% of them, and reapply them to something supporting the strategic plan, and how for Senator for that.
Deputy Mayor Andrews is seconding. All in favor? That's carried. Are there any other questions for the future budget committee meetings are September 3rd, October 1st, November 5th, all Tuesdays, 5 p.m. here in Council Chambers. And with that, we'll adjourn.